The seas and oceans of the world are full of armaments. For years, the sea has been used as an immense military rubbish tip. The amount of military war surplus dumped in the sea around Italy is large enough to pose a serious threat, not only to the environment, but also to those who fish and scour the seafloor. A particular aspect of this kind of pollution is the changes that occur over time. After the war surplus has been dumped, these devices are corroded by the seawater and leak toxic chemical agents. In 1997, the Minister for the Environment and others were spurred into action by numerous parliamentary inquiries. ICRAM was charged with the task of setting up and carrying out the research project, which was named ACAB, Dumped Chemical Armaments and Benthos. The aim of the project was to investigate the distribution and state of conservation of the chemical weapons dumped in the southern Adriatic. The research also aimed to establish the level of danger they represent in the marine environment. The European Commission co-financed the RED COD program, which enabled the development of the research initiated in the ACAB program. The project was coordinated by ICRAM. The other participants included the CETLI, the Military Technical Logistic Interforce NBC Center, the Siena and Bari units of CONISIMA, and the Department of Biomedicine and Molecular Immunology of the CNR in Palermo. The principal objectives were to establish the effects and risks to the bentonic ecosystem caused by the leaking of chemical pollutants, obtain better knowledge of the quantity and type of munitions dumped in the sea off the Apulian coast, identify the best technological equipment available to clean up the affected areas of the seafloor.
There are different types of chemical warfare agents which experts have classified according to the type of damage that they cause. Blistering agents, irritants, cellular toxic agents, asphyxiating agents, and nerve agents. Mustard gas is the principal chemical agent found in the bombs dumped in this area.
Iprite 1.2, dichloroethyl sulfide, better known as mustard gas, was first used by the Germans in an artillery attack on the night between the 12th and 13th of July 1917 at Ypres in Flanders. It is a liquid with a low vapor pressure. It has a garlic or mustard-like odor. It's a blistering agent and has a general toxic effect, provoking skin necrosis, cardiovascular disorders, and in the long term it can cause tumors. During the First World War, 125,000 tons of chemical warfare agents were used, causing 2.5% of the victims of the Great War. Under the 1922 Treaty of Versailles and the Geneva Convention of 1925, which was promoted by the League of Nations, the use of chemical weapons was banned. Despite this veto, in the period between the two wars, most countries, including Italy, continued to carry out experiments in order to improve the efficiency of their chemical weapons and to develop new ones. During the Second World War, the right of retaliation stipulated by the Geneva Convention potentially justified the use of chemical weapons in retaliation to a chemical warfare attack. The warring countries developed munitions containing chemical warfare agents, which were ready to be used. The bombing of the USS John Harvey in the port of Bari by a fleet of Luftwaffe, which sank along with another 16 ships on the evening of the 2nd of December 1943, demonstrates this potential scenario. The US Liberty was secretly loaded with at least 15,000 aerial bombs made in the United States, containing about 450 tons of Levinstein Iprite. This was one of the most tragic Allied naval disasters, second only to the bombing of Pearl Harbor. It had a devastating effect, particularly on the population of the old town of Bari. There were more than 1,000 victims, including military servicemen and civilians. Some of the victims were poisoned by Iprite fumes, or by the deadly mixture of Iprite and naphtha emitted into the water of the port and soaked into the survivors' clothing. As in other Italian ports bombed during the war, cleanup operations were carried out in Bari at the end of the conflict. The munitions recovered from the wrecks and from the surrounding seafloor were dumped off the coast.
Many ships loaded with dangerous chemical warfare agents were sunk in the port of Bari. For some years, between 43 and 47, they caused devastating problems to the population of Bari. The full effects of the 2nd of December and the number of victims contaminated, port workers, seamen, and even the population of the old town, are not known. At the time, many of us, particularly the young people, used to swim in the harbor. Many people were taken to hospital covered in boils, even really big ones, caused by the mustard gas.
The huge quantity of chemical weapons on the Apulian seafloor also come from the disposal of war surplus from Italian, German, and Anglo-American arsenals, and from armament production plants.
It was only after 10 years that it became known that there was a chemical weapon factory in Foggia. It was built secretly between 41 and 42 by the Germans.
The Dottor Soronio factory, officially a beer factory, was used to produce chemical warfare agents for the Axis forces. From 1941, the factory produced about 200 tons of Iprit and 100 tons of Difosgene per month. On the 28th of September 1943, the retreating German army mined and destroyed the factory.
The discovery by the Anglo-American forces of the Nazi-fascist military plant led to the use of Bari and other Apulian ports as deposits for a huge quantity of extremely dangerous chemical weapons, which were rerouted to Puglia by the US forces immediately after the Anglo-American landing.
Dirottate dagli Stati Uniti in Puglia subito dopo lo sbarco anglo-americano.
Once the war was over, the Apulian ports had to be cleared of the war surplus that lay on their seabeds. The cleanup operations were carried out by the deep sea divers of the anti-mine unit of the Italian Navy. All the munitions collected at Bari port were then transported offshore and dumped.
A complicare ulteriormente la situazione.
During the cleanup operations in the ports of the southern Adriatic, the situation was further complicated by problems relating to the disposal of large Anglo-American military deposits situated along the coast.
The agreement between the Merchant Marine Ministry and the Allies stipulated that chemical weapons must be dumped at least 20 miles from the coast and at a minimum depth of 460 meters. However, given the enormous quantity of military surplus to be disposed of, these operations were also carried out using fleets of fishing boats paid by the load. The fishermen often dumped the surplus materials en route in order to increase the number of trips they could make and to save on fuel consumption.
The fishermen loaded on board these bombs, filled with mustard gas, to take them to the international waters and dump them. As they say, dishonesty was thought of before man was even born. So what did these fishermen do? While they were loading them onto the boats, some of them dropped them into the harbor. Others were dumped along the coast, so they could do more trips and earn more. When they got near Vieste, they just threw them overboard.
In some cases, dumped surplus was recovered from the seabed for their metal and explosives. Due to the number of accidents involving workmen during cleanup operations caused by chemical weapons recovered together with conventional munitions, hundreds and thousands of surplus materials were left on the seafloor. The SDAI, the anti-mine unit of the Italian Navy, recovered between 1974 and 1977 in the area around Torre Gavettone alone 837,089 munitions, 1,157 of which were chemical weapons. Dumping operations in the southern Adriatic involved very different types of chemical weapons. The underwater arsenal includes aerial bombs, artillery shells, mines, and grenades. Most of these munitions have a very thin metal casing, between 2 and 6 millimeters in thickness, which can be easily corroded by the sea and by the chemical warfare agents themselves. In an advanced state of corrosion, the toxic contents of the munitions may leak out, making the identification of the type of chemical warfare agent impossible. In fact, deterioration has led not only to the alteration of components like hooks, metal bands, and loading hole coverings, but also the cancelling of colors and codes, which are often the only way of distinguishing conventional weapons from chemical munitions.
Of all the cases reported in Italy of intoxication and burns regarding fishermen caused by exhalations emanating from chemical war surplus recovered in fishing nets, over 200 have been recorded in the southern Adriatic alone.
In the summer of 1946, an entire fishing crew was affected by the effects of a lethal gas emitted from an unexploded weapon caught in their nets. The 11 fishermen arrived at the hospital in Molfetta with respiratory difficulties, blisters covering their bodies, and they were unable to open their eyes due to the swelling of their eyelids. 2 weeks later, the 5 most seriously affected had died. This was the first of a long line of incidents.
Most seamen working on the fishing boats with trawling nets have caught incendiary bombs, and some, the more guileless, touched them with their hands and had to be taken to hospital urgently. It was a tragedy for the fishermen of the area.
An epidemiological study carried out by the University of Bari reported 233 cases of intoxication by Iprit in the sea near the city of Molfetta from 1946 to 1996.
30, 35 years ago, there were people who had burns on their eyes, hands, and legs. While we were taking in the nets, we found this cylinder. We threw it back in the sea, but the net broke. After, while we were sewing it up, we inhaled this gas. At about 10:30 in the evening, we started coughing and felt a burning sensation in our eyes. And so we were forced to go back to Molfetta. We were all admitted to hospital.
Particularly around Manfredonia, it is possible to recover incendiary devices loaded with white phosphorus. The characteristic of this substance is that it remains unaltered in water, but when it comes into contact with oxygen in the atmosphere, it sets alight. When it is taken on board, it can damage the fishing equipment and harm the fishermen who come into contact with the substance.
Sometimes, when we are taking in the nets, the bomb is lying in the sack. When you catch one, you just don't know whether or not to save the catch, taking on board the bomb. Even while we take in the nets, smoke comes out, but we have to keep our eyes open because we know it can set alight.
ICRAM has been able to identify the principal war surplus dumping sites in the southern Adriatic through archival research, interviews, and by consulting nautical maps and shipping notices. These are not particularly limited areas, given that, as stated previously, the cleanup operations were also carried out by fishermen on fishing vessels, who for economic reasons often dumped the materials en route and not in the indicated areas. When fishermen recover munitions, they tend to throw them back into the sea in a different place from the one where it lay previously. ICRAM, in collaboration with military experts from Celti, Civitavecchia, have published an explanatory manual of the precautionary measures to adopt in the case of accidental recovery of war surplus in trawling nets. The manual is targeted at the seamen of the Adriatic. The aim is to give information and advice concerning the procedures to adopt in the case of accidental recovery of war material and concerning first aid measures in the case of contamination of the vessel or personnel.
In July 1999, in the ACAB project, exploration of a rectangular area of the 10 nautical square miles was carried out, 35 miles off the coast of Molfetta. The preliminary investigations indicated a large concentration of dumped war surplus.
Thanks to the use of electroacoustic instruments, the side scan sonar and the sub-bottom profiler, and magnetometer, it was possible to identify 102 targets, most probably dumped munitions on the seafloor. 16 of these targets were selected for direct observation using a wire-guided robot, equipped with a video camera, a magnetometer, and two samplers to take sediment and water samples in the area around the device. It was therefore possible to study 9 aerial bombs and 2 artillery shells loaded with IPRIT. The chemical warfare agent contained in the device also appeared to have spread to the surrounding sediment. The mobile but firm characteristics of the substrata has stopped the war surplus materials from being buried in the sediment. Direct observations have also allowed us to identify belts around the central body of some of the munitions. This leads us to believe that the dumping operations were not carried out en masse, but rather that the bombs were dumped one at a time. During the research project, the researchers were provided with protective equipment to protect them from any contamination while handling the samples collected. The instruments used on the seafloor were thoroughly cleaned after being brought back on board. IPRIT degradation products were detected using the analysis of the sediment samples. During the summer of 2004, sampling activities concerning demersal marine organisms were carried out. The aim of this task was to establish the consequences of the release of pollutants from dumped war surplus, both from conventional and chemical weapons, for the marine environment. Two areas of study were chosen: the waters around the island of Pianosa in the Tremiti archipelago, where a large number of conventional weapons can be found in the shallow waters; the stretch of sea 10 nautical square miles in width, situated about 35 miles off the coast of Molfetta. This area was already investigated during the RED project and is affected by the presence of chemical weapons. Pianosa is a fully protected marine reserve and is one of the islands of the Tremiti archipelago. It is uninhabited, and therefore there are not any other particular sources of pollution on the island. It is at a distance of about 12 nautical miles from the other islands. It is therefore an ideal study area. This is because the only actual source of pollution could come from the rusting war materials. The traces of the impact of the bombs are easily identifiable on the island. Pieces of metal melted into the rocks can be found. However, there are no craters or other signs of explosion. This would suggest that the island was used as a marine military exercise ground. ICRM has carried out numerous diving exhibitions on the seafloor around the coast of Pianosa, confirming the presence of a large quantity of war surplus. They have been classified as American aerial bombs by military experts from the SDAI. Many of these appear to have lost their vane or tail fins following impact with the seafloor. This reinforces the hypothesis that we are dealing with surplus which was deliberately dropped into the sea by aircraft or ships. The samples to be collected were set down in the adopted sampling protocol. It includes the capture of a conger eel, conger conger, specimen using a sea bottom long line, and the collection of sea urchins, Paracentrotus lividus, to be analyzed subsequently in the laboratory. Specimen samples of the same species were collected at the same time from the waters around the islands of San Domino and Caprara in order to prepare reference data for analysis. These islands are also part of the Tremiti archipelago, and it's certain that there is no war surplus in their waters. As there are no buildings on the island, it was necessary to set up a makeshift camp equipped with a laboratory for the dissection of the specimens and for the preparation and preservation of the samples. In order to establish the effects of toxic molecules on the presumably contaminated organisms, the following analyses were carried out using a multidisciplinary approach: analysis of the contents of explosive compounds and their degradation products, development of indicators of enzymatic activity alteration in the liver, the muscles, the brain, and the gills, evaluation of DNA damage using the so-called micronucleus test, Examination of HSP70 protein production in the coelomocytes of sea urchins, indicator of suffering of the organism. Prior scientific information indicating that trinitol-toluene and its degradation products do not accumulate in the tissues of the exposed organisms was confirmed.
Despite this, the investigation methodology employed has allowed us to highlight that the animals observed are subject to environmental stress. These stress indicators, in particular the indicators regarding certain hepatic enzymes, demonstrate that they have been significantly altered compared to fish samples caught in other areas around the Tremiti Islands.
A similar protocol was employed in the sampling activities undertaken in the identified area off the coast of Molfetta. A sea bottom long line was used and a makeshift laboratory was set up on board the fishing boat. 20 sample specimens of black-belly rosefish, Helicolinus dactylopterus, and 20 conger eel were taken. These fish live in direct contact with the seafloor and have been observed inside the fissures of some of the aerial bombs. Overall, the results of the analysis compared to those from the samples taken in an uncontaminated area of the Sicilian Tirreno indicate the existence of anomalies linked to compounds leaking from the bombs. Lesions to the skin of some conger eel specimens have been detected. Microscopic investigations indicated that they were caused by blistering agents. Arsenic and mercury content found in the mussels and gills is significantly higher in the specimens taken from the area off the coast at Molfetta than in the test group samples. The stress index values were also significantly altered. Evident damage to DNA was observed. This confirms high levels of genetic mutation detected in studies on the exposure of guinea pigs to Iprit.
The ideal solution is to clean up completely the seafloor. But in order to take into account this option, we have to consider that we face at least three kinds of difficulties. First of all, the depth. The majority of the weapons lies below 250 meters. The second is the scattering of all the weapons. They are dispersed on a vast portion of the seafloor. And the third is the safety and health of the operators. Talking about chemical weapons, we know that one single bomb can be lethal for the operators.
There are essentially two possible cleanup options: covering the war surplus in limited areas on the seafloor, also known as capping; recovery and disposal of the materials. Covering the surplus materials with sediments using capping techniques could be an effective solution in order to stop the pollutant contents from spreading into the marine environment. The leakage of pollutants represents a source of danger for fishermen using trawling nets and activities on the seafloor. Although it is not permanent, it could be an effective solution, particularly with regards to the problem concerning wrecks containing chemical weapons. The recovery of the munitions can be carried out using robotic systems. Due to the state of corrosion of the munitions, moving them could cause breakage and the leaking of their contents into the surrounding environment. The ROV, appropriately equipped, transfers the munitions into an airtight container. It is then collected by the support ship.
Those means that a plan has to be worked out, a plan that has to take into account the need for mapping, the need for assessing the environmental risk associated within each of the mapped area, and as well to prioritize the need for intervention. At the same time, our capacity of tackle the chemical weapons have to be increased in order to match the workload really needed.
Since the 70s, in order to dispose of obsolete war materials, dumping at sea was common practice worldwide. A well-known case is that of the Nazi chemical weapon arsenal discovered by Allied troops at the end of the war. A total of 296,103 tons of chemical weapons were found. The United States, in the operation known as Davy Jones Locker, sank in the Skagerrak Strait in the North Sea at a depth of between 650 and 1,200 meters, 11 ships loaded with German chemical weapons. In many cases, the armament-producing countries took responsibility for dumping the chemical weapons found in their own territory. In addition to the Mediterranean, the main voluntary chemical war surplus dumping areas are the Baltic and the North Sea, where the largest number of German chemical weapons lie, the North Channel between Scotland and Ireland, where the dumping of the British chemical weapon arsenal took place, the waters around the coast of the Atlantic Ocean, where the United States dumped mainly rockets loaded with nerve gas, the Sea of Japan, where the Japanese got rid of their chemical armaments, the waters around Australia, the munitions which were to be used in the war in the Southeast Pacific were accumulated in Australian territory. It has now become apparent that the post-war decision to dump in the sea the enormous chemical arsenal produced over the years by the different nations was not the answer to the problem, but rather a way of delegating to future generations the task of finding a definitive solution.